Isaisa Charita, Chapter 2. Object of writing the work, incapacity and boldness in the undertaking, hot discussion, conferring significant and prophetic title of Dhemat Panth, necessity of a guru. In the last chapter, the author mentioned in the original Marathi book that he would state the reason that led him to undertake the work and about the persons qualified to read the same and such other points. Now in this chapter, he narrates the same. The object of writing this work. In the first chapter, I described Sai Baba's miracle of checking and destroying the cholera epidemic by grinding wheat and throwing the flour on the outskirts of the village. I heard other miracles of Sai Baba to my great delight, and this delight burst forth into this poetic work. I also thought that the description of these miracles of Sai Baba would be interesting and instructive to his devotees and would remove their sins, and so I began to write the sacred life and teachings of Sai Baba. The life of the saint is neither logical nor dialectical. It shows us the true and great path. Incapacity and boldness in undertaking the work. Hemant Pant thought that he was not a fit person to undertake the work. He said, "I do not know the life of my intimate friend, nor do I know my own mind. Then how can I write the life of a saint or describe the nature of incarnations, which even the Vedas were unable to do? One must be a saint himself before he could know other saints. Otherwise, how can I describe their glory? To write the life of a saint is most difficult. One may as well be able to measure the depth of the seven seas or enclose the sky with cloth trappings. I knew this was the most venturous undertaking, which might expose me to ridicule. I therefore invoke Sai Baba's grace." The premier poet saint of Maharashtra, Sri Dhyaneshwar Maharaj, has stated that the Lord loves those who write the lives of saints, and the saints also have their own peculiar method of assigning the service which the devotees long for. The saint inspires the work, the devotee becomes only an indirect cause or an instrument in achieving the end. For instance, in 1700 Shaka year, the poet Mahipati aspired to write the lives of saints. Saints inspired him and got the work done. So also in 1800 Shaka year, Das Kanu's service was accepted. The former wrote four works, Bhakt Vijay, Sant Vijay, Bhakt Leelamrit and Sant Leelamrit, while the latter wrote two, Bhakt Leelamrit and Sant Kathamrit, in which the lives of modern saints were described. In chapters 31, 32, 33 of Bhakt Leelamrit and in chapter 57 of Sant Kathamrit, the life and teachings of Sai Baba are very well depicted. These have been separately published in Sai Leela magazine, numbers 11 and 12, volume 17. The readers are advised to read these chapters. So also Sai Baba's wonderful leelas are described by Mrs. Savitri Bai Raghunath Tendulkar of Bandra in a small book named Sri Sainath Bhajan Mala. Das Kanu Maharaj also has composed various sweet poems on Sai Baba. A devotee named Amidas Bhavani Mehta has also published some stories of Sai Baba in Gujarati. Some numbers of Sainath Prabha, a magazine published by Dakshina Bhiksha Sanstha of Shirdi, are also published. Then the question of objection comes in, that while so many works regarding Sai Baba are extant, why should this Sat Charita be written and where is its necessity? The answer is plain and simple. The life of Sai Baba is as wide and deep as the infinite ocean, and all can dive deep into the same and take out precious gems of knowledge and bhakti and distribute them among the aspiring people. The stories, parables and teachings of Sai Baba are very wonderful. They will give peace and happiness to the people who are afflicted with sorrows and heavily loaded with miseries of this worldly existence, and also bestow knowledge and wisdom both in worldly and in spiritual domains. If these teachings of Sai Baba, which are as interesting and instructive as the Vedic lore, are listened to and meditated upon, the devotees will get what they long for, viz. Union with Brahma, mastery in Eightfold Yoga, bliss of meditation, etc. So I thought that I should collect these stories together, that would be my best upasana. This collection would be most delightful to those simple souls whose eyes were not blessed with Sai Baba's darshan. So I set about collecting Sai Baba's teachings and expressions, the outcome of his boundless self-realization. It was Sai Baba who inspired me in this matter. In fact, I surrendered my ego at his feet and thought that my path was clear and that he would make me quite happy here and in the next world. I could not myself ask Sai Baba to give me permission for this work, so I requested Mr. Madhav Rao Deshpande alias Shama, Baba's most intimate devotee, to speak to him for me. He pleaded my cause and said to Sai Baba, "This Anna Sahib wishes to write your biography. Don't say that you are a poor fakir and there is no necessity to write it. But if you agree and help him, he will write, or rather your grace will accomplish the work. Without your consent and blessing, nothing can be done successfully." When Sai Baba heard this request, he was moved and blessed me by giving me his udi, sacred ash, and placing his boon bestowing hand on my head, said, "Let him make a collection of stories and experiences. Keep notes and memos. I will help him. He is only an outward instrument. I should write my autobiography myself and satisfy the wishes of my devotees. He should get rid of his ego, surrender it at my feet. He who acts like this in life, him I help the most. What of my life stories, I serve him in his house in all possible ways. When his ego is completely annihilated and there is left no trace of it, I myself shall enter into him and shall myself write my own life. Hearing my stories and teachings will create faith in devotees' hearts, and they will easily get self-realization and bliss. Let there be no insistence on establishing one's own view, no attempt to refute others' opinions, no discussion of pros and cons of any subject." Significant and prophetic title. The word discussion put me in mind of my promise to explain the story of my getting the title of Hemad Pant, and now I begin to relate the same. I was on close friendly terms with Kaka Sahib Dikshit and Nana Sahib Chandorkar. They pressed me to go to Shirdi and have Baba's darshan, and I promised them to do so. But something in the meanwhile turned up which prevented me from going to Shirdi. The son of a friend of mine at Lonawala fell ill. My friend tried all possible means, physical and spiritual, but the fever would not abate. At length he got his guru to sit by the bedside of his son, but this too was of no avail. Hearing this, I thought, what was the utility of the guru if he could not save my friend's son? If the guru can't do anything for us, why should I go to Shirdi at all? Thinking this way, I postponed my Shirdi trip. But the inevitable must happen, and it happened in my case as follows. Mr. Nana Sahib Chandorkar, who was a divisional officer, was going on tour to Basin. From Thana he came to Dadar and was waiting for a train bound for Basin. Meanwhile, a Bandra local turned up. He sat in it and came to Bandra and sent for me and took me to task for putting off my Shirdi trip. Nana's argument for my Shirdi trip was convincing and delightful, and so I decided to start for Shirdi the same night. I packed up my luggage and started for Shirdi. I planned to go to Dadar and from there to catch the train for Manmad, and so I booked myself for Dadar and sat in the train. While the train was to start, a Mohammedan came hastily to my compartment and, seeing all my paraphernalia, asked me where I was bound to. I told him about my plan. He then suggested that I should go straight to Bori Bandar and not to wait at Dadar, as the Manmad mail did not stop at Dadar. If this little miracle or leela had not happened, I would not have reached Shirdi next day as settled, and many doubts would have assailed me. But that was not to be. As fortune favoured me, I reached Shirdi the next day before 9 or 10 a.m. Bhav Sahab Kaka Dikshit was waiting for me there. This was in 1910, when there was only one place with Sathe's Wada for lodging pilgrim devotees. After alighting from the Tonga, I was anxious to have darshan when the great devotee Tatya Sahib Nulkar returned from the masjid and said that Sai Baba was at the corner of the Wada and that I should first get the preliminary darshan and then after bath see him at leisure. Hearing this, I ran and prostrated before Baba, and my joy knew no bounds. I found more than what Nana Chandorkar had told me. All my senses were satisfied, and I forgot my thirst and hunger. The moment I touched Sai Baba's feet, I began a new life.